The phone call. If I crane my neck, I can just barely see the bridge out of one corner of the window in my small third floor apartment. The morning rays bounce off the bright blue of the bay in the dark orange of the span. The fog begins to move in toward the city, a white wispy mass that will soon obscure the sun, the bay, the bridge. The day will be gray and chilly and windy. It's summer, and I will wear my thick black sweatshirt later. I return to my little desk, pick up my cup of café con canela, and take a sip. Laid out in front of me are two photos. In both, the sun shines brilliantly. If I close my eyes, I can almost remember the warmth. Beside the photos is Abuelita's Virgen de Guadalupe medallion. I pick up my phone and punch in the numbers. It rings distantly just once. Hola, Miguel, Elena says before I speak. She's expecting my call. I got the picture. I still can't believe you graduated from college and with a degree in English of all things, Elena begins. We always talk about the California pictures first, the ones I send her. San Jacinto comes second. Mama looks good, but Papa looks old. I know, Elena, I know. I look at my copy of the picture, now framed on the wall. Papa's hair is white now, and some of his canas verdes are my fault. I made him suffer for the black emptiness I felt on the Matagente. It took me years to accept that Papa did what he did out of love, not pride. Papa refused to be obligated to Don Clemente, a complicated and dangerous man, in any way. He rebuffed every one of Don Clemente's offers to help until he could no longer stand it. Then finally, no Lina mattered. What do you think of the twins, I ask. They look so grown up. I can't wait to see them next summer when they come to visit, Elena said. I've grown to love my little sisters, the hermanas I'd never known or held until I came north. The cuates are smart, a little sassy, and strong like Elena. But I feel a familiar twinge of envy. Maria and Liliana have advantages they don't appreciate or understand. Papa and Mama made sure their Spanish was good, but English might as well be their first and only language, the way the words just tumble out of their mouths so naturally and easily. Papa and Mama never left my sister's sides, not even for a day. Maria and Liliana never had to wonder when or if they would see their parents again. And the twins are citizens. They can go to Mexico and come back whenever they want. For them, there is no Lina. What do you think of my pictures? Elena asks. I take my time. I don't want to hurry with this call. This one we make once a year on this day. I pick up the first photo. There's Elena, the one who claimed she wanted to go north more than anyone, right back there on Abuelita's rancho in San Jacinto. Elena returned as soon as Papa let her, right after she finished high school. Even Mama wasn't enough to keep her in California. She says that El Norte never measured up to what she imagined it would be. Elena is standing amidst her tomatoes, organic ones, in yellow, orange, red, and even pink. In her hands, she holds a chunk of organic goat cheese, whatever that is. She brags that her foods are becoming very popular in La Capital, at the best restaurants. What's up with your hair? I ask. Are you growing it out or what? Gone is her little cap of short black hair. It's longer, falling now to her chin, framing her face in gentle waves of black. It's been 10 years, Miguel, she announces. It's time to move on. I don't remind her that she said she would never grow it out. She vowed to keep it short, the way Javi cut it before the Matagente, to help her remember los sacrificios people make for each other. I can't ever forget Javi anyway. It doesn't matter what my hair looks like, she says. You think about him too, I know you do. She can still read my mind, and I can still read hers. Elena wants to believe that Javier might have made it out of the desert somehow. Javi could have survived, somehow. He could be working in New York, just like he said. He could have sent for his family, and they're all together. But I don't think so. Miguelito is big, isn't he? Elena says. There in the picture is Chewy, holding mi sobrino. Chewie's smile spreads all the way across his wide face, a picture of pure happiness. He had to beg and beg, but Elena finally agreed to marry him. The baby was born a year ago. He is named Miguel Javier Moises. Elena chose his names and the sequence. She said it is the correct order. Good thing he looks like Chewie, I tease. Cállate, feo, Elena says back. Good thing he doesn't look like his tío. Guess what? There's a catalog in the States that might be interested in some of Chewie's and the others' artwork. Say a prayer. We could make some money, maybe, for a change. It's about time, I say. I pause. In the package, Miguel? Elena asks finally. I was wondering how long it would take her to get around to it. You were supposed to send Abuelita's medallion. Why didn't you? I gather my thoughts. Elena waits, and we both remember. 10 years ago to the day, Elena and I left San Jacinto. 9 years ago to the day, Abuelita died. Her heart failed her. Doña Maria found her sitting in a chair in the kitchen, a pile of chiles in front of her, ready to be peeled, the kind that bring fierce tears from their juices when they touch your fingers and then your eyes. She is buried at the edge of the old cornfield on her beloved rancho. I still have the medallion, I finally confess. I know we agreed that this year she would be reunited with La Virgen, but today's the anniversary of her death, Elena interrupts, and of the day we left, and of the promise she made to Chewie and Lalo to come back. Lalo's even taking a day off at the clinic to come. I think of all the people I won't or can't see. Lalo, Chewie, Elena, the nephew I have never held, Abuelita, Javi, and Moises. There's no belonging here or in San Jacinto or anywhere without longing. Y el Virgencita? Elena asks. Her voice has dropped to a whisper. She's staying here with me until I can cross La Línea and come back again freely, I explain. Okay, Miguel. Elena's voice is almost inaudible now. If it means you'll come someday, okay. Te quiero mucho, Miguel. I love you very much. I love you too. I hang up the phone. We don't say goodbye. We never do. The fog has moved in. It covers the whole bridge now, except for the very southern end. I'm going to walk all the way across the bridge today because I have never done it, because I want to see what's there to the north on the other side. I put on my sweatshirt, zip it up tight, look at myself in the mirror. There's the same old Miguel I was in San Jacinto, just a little taller. My face filled out some, a new mustache beginning to sprout. On the outside, the same me. Inside, it's different. I thought I would find the real Miguel, the one I thought I could not be in Mexico once I crossed La Línea. I didn't understand that there are thousands of Líneas to cross in a lifetime. Sometimes you see the border and you can walk right across, eyes wide open. You know you will change. You know everything will be different. Other times you don't know you've crossed a border until you reach the other side, until you turn and look back at La Línea, surprised. Later, I will call Papa and let him know what I've decided to do next with my life. I will tell him all about the next Línea I'm planning to cross, and maybe the one after that. About this book. La Línea is the result of the fortunate convergence of my married and professional lives. This book would not have happened without both. When my husband, Luis, and I met and fell in love in 1971, I was welcomed into his family. The Jamarillos have taught me a deep appreciation for the complex nature of Mexican families in the United States. They have shown me that there are many ways to be Mexican and American, culturally and linguistically. They also illustrate the different ways Americans of Mexican descent are citizens of this country. Jamarillos have lived for many, many generations in New Mexico. My father-in-law, Lalo, liked to remind us, we didn't come to the United States. The United States came to us. My mother-in-law, Tomasa, called Tommy, grew up in El Paso, Texas. Both her parents were immigrants from Mexico. Luis and his 5 siblings were all born and raised in El Paso, right on the border. In fact, you can see the border from the family house. Lalo and Tommy never turned away anyone who came to the door, hungry and scared, straight from the other side of the Rio Grande River. While Luis became a lawyer, I became a middle school teacher. His career had been dedicated to seeking equal justice for migrant farm workers and their families, most of whom are Mexican immigrants. Like my husband's clients, more than 95% of my students are Mexican in origin. Their parents work in the fields or packing sheds of the Salinas Valley. Some of my students were born in the United States, others immigrated in elementary or middle school. La Línea is fiction, but it is based on real events. The Mata Gente is real, although it is known by several different nicknames in Mexico. Migrants traveling through Mexico often hop trains as a way to get north, facing constant physical danger. The Mexican government has established formal procedures to deter migration through Mexico and across its southern and northern borders. People in pueblitos in Mexico, particularly in Veracruz, routinely throw food and other goods to migrants on the trains. These are humble communities whose residents care deeply about the plight of the migrants. They have few resources, but they give what they can. Private American citizens, individually and in organized groups, patrol and enforce immigration on the United States side of the border. Many immigrants lose their lives attempting to cross the border. In the Sonoran Desert area of Arizona alone, several hundred die each year from dehydration, hypothermia, or violence. Thousands have died in the border area that stretches from California across Arizona and New Mexico to Texas. Operation Gatekeeper was instituted by the U.S. Border Patrol in 1994 as a strategy to check the flow of immigrants at traditional border crossings. This effort has pushed immigrants to cross at increasingly remote, uninhabited, and dangerous parts of the border. Humanitarian efforts save many, many lives at the border. Human rights, religious, and political organizations work tirelessly to safeguard immigrants. Hundreds of thousands are apprehended and deported at the border each year, but just as many make it across. An unknown number of children and teenagers with and without parents or relatives to help them. Most are willing to attempt the crossing multiple times. The total number of undocumented people in the United States is estimated to be more than 10 million. 60% are from Mexico, 20% are from Central America, and 20% are from Asia and other places. Which takes me back to my own students. Many, many of my students have been and continue to be new arrival immigrants, 12, 13, 14 years old. They set foot in my classroom, not knowing a word of English, some having survived a journey that is daunting for even the hardiest of individuals. From them, I have learned the meaning of optimism, courage, and determination. This is their story. I wrote it for them.